It's had a few names, this treaty camp. No Surrender Camp, Sacred Ground Camp. What it ultimately is the route to the pipeline through our treaty territory and through sites that Tim Mentz, the former Standing Rock, long time Standing Rock Tribal Historic Preservation Officer, identified. Just in the past couple of days, we have learned that rock formations were made by our people to represent our Big Dipper constellation. That camp was established as kind of a stand against the pipeline coming, you know, to the Highway 1806. It was hastily put together out of necessity. There wasn't unity in Ocheté Shokoi or among those who consider themselves or are the self-appointed leaders of Ocheté Shokoi to support the camp. It was never properly defended. It was ripe for what happened on Thursday, October 27th. Everything north of the Cannonball River, all land north of the Cannonball River to the Heart River, the Little Heart River, just south of Mandan, is unceded Lakota Treaty territory from the Treaty of 1851, affirmed by the Treaty of 1868. The camp was meant to protect those sacred sites and assert those treaty rights, assert those unceded territory tracts as ours, or reclaim them as ours, I meant to say. The people who led the establishment of that camp are unknown to me. They're unknown to most people here. The camp never had a chance in retrospect, because we never anticipated the level of government violence that would be visited upon us to clear it out so that the pipeline could be completed. The events that led up to Thursday, October 27th, go back to the Saturday before that. I think it would be, what would it be, the 20th of October. We knew the pipeline was getting closer, and despite all of our actions previous to that, we hadn't slowed them down by a day. A call went out on Friday the 19th, that night, that there would be significant action the next morning. That's all of us in camp who are the grassroots are ever told about actions. On Saturday the 20th, the criers went out early, about 5 o'clock in the morning, to Kikdapo, wake up, Inajipo, stand up, gather at the south gate like we usually did when we caravan to an action. Arriving at the south gate that morning of the 20th, we were told that we were going to be having a march in support of relatives who were already locked down on DAPL equipment. There were things different about that morning, in hindsight, that should have been red flags. When we gathered, there were no chanupa, there were no sacred pipe like there usually was. There were no aloha waha, sacred song sung. We had a large gathering, especially for that early in the morning. There were hundreds of people. We left the camp and drove the short drive north on 1806 to the treaty camp, No Surrender Camp, Sacred Ground Camp. We gathered in the ditches there and to the west, where the pipeline route has already been plowed through and where the dog action took place. And we did sing songs there, and we were told again that we were going to support relatives in lockdown. The march began onto the work site and was progressing, and at least 150 people of our people had made it a significant portion out onto the pipeline route, the march route, when a woman stood up in the ditch along the highway and denounced what was occurring, claiming that it would be a further desecration of our own sacred sites for us to march out there, that we didn't know where we were going. This immediately halted people from continuing to join the march and join those that had already marched out. I was walking along when I was approached from behind and told, you need to hear what's being said. So I went back to the highway, and by the time I made it there, I heard the last part of what this person had said in appealing to not do the action that we were doing. A Paiute man began speaking out loud then, and there were at least a couple hundred people still in the ditch, that we needed to wait, that we needed elders, that we needed to respect what this woman was saying and not go forward. But it was too late. We already had, like I said, at least 150 relatives marching out. I personally felt and was led to believe that the pipeline was not far from where we were. It was described as being just over the hill from where we were. I said that, after the Paiute man, when Paiute man was talking, he said, we are guests here and we need to respect what this woman's saying. I shouted out, I'm not a guest here. Ma Itázipčho Lakȟóta, I'm Itázipčho Lakȟóta, and I'm in my ancestral homeland. That we did have people who could guide us in a good way to avoid the sacred sites that had been identified, that we were at the head of the march. We were told that. And that there was a black snake over the hill, and I'd come here to fight it, and that's what I was going to do. And I said, Bliahichi apo, take courage. So I turned around and walked out to do what I had gone there to do, which was to protect water and support relatives who were making tremendous sacrifice in lockdown, who were going to be looking at felony charges. I don't know if anybody followed after me, but I know people did. I don't know if they were following, you know, their own conscience or whatever dictate, because after I got done talking, I heard more talk going on, but I was so frustrated by then, because we had basically been split at the start by our own people, by a local person who, if they were aware of that any time previous to our people beginning that march, should have spoke up then. I would have supported saying, okay, let's stay off of there. But by then we had so many marching that we had to support them. We couldn't just cut them off. We couldn't, you know, or cut off the further support for them. It was, you know, we were committed then. We marched a long time, and every ridgeline that appeared, it was like, it's got to be right over there. You know, it's got to be right over the hill here. Every time we crossed the ridgeline, all we saw was more pipeline route with pipeline not laid. Wherever our relatives were in lockdown, we never saw them. The sun began rising, and finally the main group, or whoever led the march, whoever was in charge, stopped, thankfully so, and they said, we need to move as one. We're gonna, for some reason, they only stopped for 10 minutes. There were at least 150 people in that main body, more maybe, and then more than 100 strung out along a long line. You know, we're supposed to move as one, stay together as one. That wasn't happening. And when the march began and I still saw all these people coming from the highway, I was like, what are we doing? I needed to rest. I'm sick. I have fatty liver disease, and it's incurable. I have peripheral neuropathy throughout my body. I needed to rest longer than just 10 minutes, and I did. More passed, filed past me and kept going along the pipeline route. Rugged terrain, broken up earth, difficult walking. But I knew there were many elderly and other sick people who were ahead of me and continuing on, pressing on. So I knew I had to get going, and I started getting going again. After about a mile and a half, we came upon this high ridge line. And when I got to that top of that ridge, there was a steep hill that went down into a creek below us, a running creek. And along that route, Dapple had constructed one of their makeshift wooden bridges so the equipment could cross over. And right across the creek was heavy machinery. A few police units, some police, but not a large presence at all. But in addition to seeing that, you could see quite a ways down the pipeline route. And wherever our relatives were locked down in the equipment, we couldn't see for miles. And I could not believe that we were marching like that when we had so many elderly and young people in the march. The main group broke down that ridge line, and I couldn't see most of them. And those of us who were on the ridge and were staying there couldn't really see them because they had gone to find a place to cross the creek. And evidently found one, but in doing so, they had crossed over onto different private property of a local landowner. And then we saw them begin to march across an open field there. Somebody, one of the security, was down by the bridge below us there on the ridge, and he began yelling, "We need to hold this bridge." And I agreed, not that we needed to hold the bridge, but that we should have stayed on top of that ridge line. It was very steep going up there. Difficult to walk up. Easy for a four-wheel drive to pop it, but they would be popping over into the unknown. And I felt that if we put warriors, those who were able-bodied, those who were able to make physical sacrifice on that line, we could have held that ridge for a little while. So we stayed there. And they were calling for people to come down to the bridge. Well, there were only about 20, 30 of us up there then, and many tried to go down, but it was so steep going down that hill that only six or seven of us ended up down by the bridge. And there were 16 law enforcement. We crossed and we counted. So we figured we've got 16 of theirs right here. There's only six of us. Good trade because of the main body moving. I had hoped and said to a couple people, bring them back and let's just stay here. You know, we've come far enough. But they just kept going. About 200 by then, marching across this open field. So the six of us were down there, and I looked over at the law enforcement, and I knew we only had a few people. So I called out to them that you have weapons, we have prayers. We will not join you with weapons, but please join us with prayers. My niece went to the bridge, kneeled down, and began to pray. I sat down beside her on a dirt windrow for the road. I was feeling sick, and my liver was really angry. So I began to pray and studying law enforcement. Well, a few of our people decided to start walking along the creek and just see how they'd respond and what they do. And that's when I noticed there were two men in camouflage. I don't know if they were guardsmen. I don't know if they were tactical police units, sheriff's units, whatever, but they were dressed fully in camo and they had long rifles. And they were in a pillbox structure made out of these railroad ties all around. And that's when we noticed that they were watching us with their binoculars and everything. And the people, our people that were, there were only a couple of them, going up and down the creek probing, they were paying attention to them. A couple people tried to cross the creek, and they were ordered back by the law enforcement not to cross the creek. After I had estimated it was about 10, 15 minutes, maybe longer, it's hard to say for sure. And the law enforcement that we were across from ordered us to leave. And so I called out to the few that were around us, we need to get going now, time to go, because our philosophy with the direct actions, the philosophy we were taught was no one left behind, stay together as one. And I think that's a good philosophy, and I agreed with it. For some reason, a couple of our people didn't want to leave right away. But we could see more law enforcement arriving just where we were. And from the creek, we couldn't see where the main body had gone. They'd kind of disappeared over a rise on the plain. So we went up that hill again. And by the time I got to the top of the hill, I needed to rest. So I sat down on top of the hill on the ridge. And that's when we noticed where our main body had gone. They had formed a police line at the fence line. And our people were marching toward this gate to cross over into the next, but that's where the police made their stand. And we could see that they had met them and then began turning back. Our people did, the way they had come. They had obviously been ordered back. We could hear some shouting and yelling, but much of it was indistinct. As our people began marching back, the police got in their units and more were arriving the whole time. They went back to the pipeline route and came down that road towards us in force, in mass. I assumed they were going to be coming up the ridge at us, you know, where we were, because there was only a handful of us up there, and, you know, they were going to clear us out. You know, and we were moving, you know, we were just watching our people. But instead, when they got to the bridge there, they began parking in long rows along the route, and scores of them, police, filed out and formed a line in the path of those retreating. A feeling came over me of dread and fear. It looked like they were just going to let them go back. But when that line formed the way it did, and then they came in from behind them, you could see they were being encircled. Some began running, and the police met those that were trying to run to get back to the highway. Eventually, we saw about 40 or 50 move off on their own and continue. And we can hear the police saying something about children and women or elderly. And we can see in that group that began moving beyond the police line, they were children, they were elderly, and they were women with children. And they were allowing them to get away from their trap. After that group moved on, the police began to move in, and we can hear crying and other things starting to emerge from the circle. It was a helpless feeling, wanting to be down there. It was so far. And they had showed up and forced the police. There was obviously a group who were quite versed in direct action within our people, because they broke off while they still had room to, and circled up, as they call it, and locked down, locked arms, and sat down in a separate group from that main body. And that's when the police became aggressive from our vantage point, and they began moving in on them. Our people remained calm given the circumstance, I feel. The police moved in and started grabbing the pickets and banners that some of our people held and began piling them. Many were crying as they moved in to arrest them. They began arresting them. We noticed that the police armored unit, the black armored vehicle that's been prominent in so many actions and on so much of the video that has emerged from the actions, made it to the bridge where we were, and it was time to get going for us. You had the feeling, watching what was unfolding on that plane there when they had encircled our people, they wanted to arrest us all. When I was 13 years old, I read Black Elk Speaks. And in Black Elk Speaks, he talks about, at the end there, being an old man sitting on a hill, that even with his old eyes, he could still see the butchered women and children from Wounded Knee lying heaped and scattered along the creek, as plain as he saw them with eyes still young. That came to me, reading that, that memory, that I was watching that. There were two older women, old women, who were up on that ridgeline with us. I begged both of them to get moving, to get going, to see what was happening, realize what was happening. We needed to get out. They wouldn't leave. I yelled at the others around us, and others were calling on them, get moving, go, we have to go now. That armored vehicle had crossed the bridge by then, but was still remaining still, but they were coming in force behind that. A relative of mine, who I went there with that day, who had gone down to see, to talk to the retreating people, had come back up, and this 70-year-old woman, I finally convinced her to go with my relative and start moving back. The other older woman said she couldn't leave. She was watching what was happening. She fell to her knees. She began praying. I said, please, we have to go. And she looked down there and she was quite emotional. I can't leave. She put her head down on the earth. I stood above her watching her as the police began moving up our hill. And I said, please, we have to go now. Please look at what's happening. She stood up and I helped her get back to the pipeline route from where we were standing and to begin moving. By then they had arrested at least five people out of that group and down in the main body. The others that had broke off across the creek, and rather than coming back to the route and going back as one, they did what I think they must have felt they had to do, and they just kept going from where they were, just getting to the highway by any means possible. By then the yellow and blue helicopter that's become so well known to those of us who've been here for a duration began buzzing us as low as I've ever seen it, harassing the retreat, harassing our people, terrorizing our people. When I was walking with this old woman, I had my arm around her. There were a few people behind us who were trying to ensure that those could get away. The police popped that ridgeline on that steep hill. And as soon as they did, I saw two of our people get arrested immediately. They began tracking us down as we were retreating and arresting as we were going. I think the only reason I wasn't arrested was because I was helping that old woman. I don't know, because it turns out many elderly women were arrested. Some younger warriors, part of security, fell back to help with us, our retreat. They gave up their freedom. It was heroic what I saw. Eventually I got help with this old woman. I didn't have to worry about her anymore. Physically I was taxed as I've never been. I was hurt, I was starting to feel sick. We had to keep going. My relative and I went with me. My relative's disabled, wears a boot, has other health issues. We were watching out for each other and we agreed that if we got arrested, we would go together. At points, we had to run because they came in such numbers. And our people were being arrested one by one, just picking us off. Helicopter buzzing, DAPL private security, spreading their own form of terror. They were in those all-terrain vehicles, four of them in each one, masked up, helmeted up, just terrorizing, coming in our flanks on the retreat. They had no authority to arrest, they were just there to terrorize, mock. Finally, some pickups, our pickups, began arriving from the highway and loading up those who weren't able to move fast enough on their own. I got my relative into the back of a pickup after running up ahead to try and encourage people, wait, we have to move as one. Some of the non-Indian with experience in direct action wanted to link up and sit down, and you do that, you're going to get arrested. They're arresting everybody. They hadn't seen what we had seen. Run. Go. Unless you want to be arrested, you need to run. Finally, a pickup came, and I was encouraged to get in the back of it, and I didn't turn it down. There were at least 40 people behind me at that point, and they were all moving. I didn't know if they were still arresting. We couldn't see anymore. We had come over another ridge, and I couldn't see what was happening beyond that. But I got in that pickup and went to the highway. My relative and another camp member who's a medic was there waiting for me. They took me to the highway. I sat down along a car and watched our people come off. You could see the trauma in their faces. You could see the trauma in their eyes. You could hear the trauma in their voices, what just had happened, what they had just seen. It turns out later we had learned that more than 100 were arrested. I've heard varying numbers, but it was more than 100. That action on Saturday, October 20th, gave many people more courage, more spiritual strength, when we realized the full extent of what they were willing to do to us. The deceitful and dirty tactic of telling people to go back, and then encircling them and trapping them filled me with rage and spiritual strength. And we had to, you know, step up our game now. This is what we were up against. The next few days were a whirlwind after Saturday.